Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. I'm going to start from some notes I have here, then with a few more notes from later on. The first thing I want to talk about is what's going in the news, and it's going everywhere. Today is about dystopia. You know, all of the 1984 books, I can't turn nowhere without hearing about 1984, Grapes of Wrath, all of those books and movies that give a dystopian view of the world, because all of a sudden it's been growing, and books like White Trash and all of that, you know, these are things that are going along in the society right now. And dystopia is just the opposite of utopia. It means just a dystopia is like, what was the movie when Denzel Washington was walking all the way and the whole world was all messed up, and about 10 years ago.
I know you're talking about.
Yeah.
The Book of Eli.
The Book of Eli, yeah. The Book of Eli was really the Bible, right?
Yeah, he had learned that,
the Book of Eli. But all those types of movies, you notice all the books and movies about the future, all these old walking dead people and zombies, and there's very few utopian that mankind has solved his problems, and you know, the water is clean, the air is fresh, and we're floating around on some kind of flying carpet. You know what I mean? Not a lot of cars and pollution. Okay, that would be utopian. That would be that human beings have solved their problems, and that they are really living in an earth as custodians. They control population, they control pollution. They don't have armies anymore because they didn't do any good, but used up all the resources. And when you think about it, think of how much resources armies, navies, marines, and air forces cost. Yes?
They say two-thirds of the Air Force's F-18s planes have been grounded because they ain't got the money to fix them.
See, not to go off the subject, but that's why we have two views. To go toward dystopia is simple. Just keep going along with the program, and you're going to get that because, number one, the reason the movie makers and the book writers write dystopian themes is because they know themselves. And they don't believe from their little reading of distorted history. They don't believe they have it in them to reach above themselves. They don't believe they can do away with wars and armies. They don't believe it. They just don't believe it. Steven Spielberg and all of them, they don't believe it. Everything you see in the future, every Star Wars, is just a repeat of the other. It's the same fighting. Fighting over and over again. Why don't you never solve that problem? Because they have projected their behavior now into the future, except it's more destructive. They believe their history as written, it has to repeat those cycles because human beings are in charge now. Not dinosaurs, not herds of buffalo. They never ran nothing. And now the human being can manage everything but himself. And the Quran talks about that. The theme is this, is that the human being, Allah gave him this charge that he would evolve and develop over and maintain and kind of control or manage everything in the earth. And he's got control of that. Everything but himself. Lions don't run nothing, they can't change nothing. You know what I mean? Alligators, tough as they are, they can't do nothing. Nothing can do anything, only the human being. So he controls, if you look at it, he controls the whole environmental circumstances on earth. But he can't control himself. His lust, his rage, his greed. That's why everything you're hearing about now is dystopian, not utopian. Okay, now, what makes us different? And we're not, we're definitely a minority, but not as big a minority as we think. When you listen to others, other people are hopeful and optimistic. They believe in possibilities that we can, that the human being can rise. And then they have some little patterns of behavior figured out, you know what I mean, that how it could happen. That's the team we own, utopia. Utopia just means good place. And it's a Greek word, so that means that throughout history, people have thought of a good place. The Indians thought when you die, you'll go to the happy hunting ground. That was heaven for him. And the old spirituals, when we go to heaven, we're going to walk on. I got shoes, you got shoes. What are we going to do in heaven? We're going to turn white as snow, because black is definitely a curse. We're going to get shoes, which we was barefooted. We didn't wear shoes in Arkansas until you started school. Most of us had shoes in school, but some still didn't. But that's when you got shoes in the country. When you needed them to go to school. You didn't need them to walk around in the woods. Okay, I got shoes, you got shoes, all of God's children got shoes. You're going to walk all over God's heaven. We're not going to do no work. That's heaven for Negroes. In those days, because all he did was hard work. He didn't ask for clean water and all of that stuff. This is not important, all the water's fine. Just, we don't want to do no whole lot of work, because that's heaven for us. For the Indians, it's the happy hunting ground, because that's how he survives, off hunting, right? So heaven to him is the happy hunting ground. So, for the Greeks, a heaven is utopia. It's possible on earth, but it takes a certain amount of training and education to produce utopia. I know all those names, Shangri-La, everything.
Nirvana.
Nirvana, everything, yeah. But you gotta reach that level of release, though, before you reach Nirvana, right? Yeah, yeah. Okay, now, so, these are competing worldviews, dystopia or utopia. So we're taking the utopian view. Okay, if you get mathematical and historical, what are the chances? We're gonna have an evolution which leads to a revolution, as we always say. But how? What's the possibilities of the human being reaching a level where the struggle that he carries on is not so confrontational and so militaristic that it destroys all possibility of a new world mechanism? See, if we have anything like the other old revolutions, we're in trouble from the beginning. So the people are thinking that's where this nonviolent resistance comes from. Now, we're in the nonviolent resistance now, and we're going to stay in it, but we're going to improve on it. Nonviolent resistance for 2000 and something, we're going to Negroize it. upgraded. We're not even going to use, we're going to use that name for a couple of years, nonviolence. This is because everybody understand it, but we got to develop a new mechanism, a new thought pattern, a new vision, because nonviolent resistance is still just linked to changing a government and da 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 da. It's not linked to a new world dispensation and all of that where all humanity cooperates da 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 to produce that. It's not any new Continental Congress, a new convention to redesign a new world situation, you know. Okay, that's what we need. That's where we have to go now. We not only have to bring down the system, not bring down the system, but we have to be in shape. First of all, the system is going down already. That is the trend. We don't have to worry about that a whole lot. But what do we have to do? This competing world views, that's why I have that Declaration of Independence on there. There's not only a Declaration of Independence, but a Declaration of Intent. When we was down at the Congress, outside of Congress the other day, we're not only talking about our Declaration of Independence, but our Declaration of Intent. And when we talked about being anti-dystopic and pro-utopian in our view, that means we move from the practical, so-called realist, to the dreamers. Okay, now, personally, the reason I took that view is because I have a choice in this. I can take the realistic view and say, well, since they're gonna mess it up, maybe I can I'll go down and make a deal with the white man and just give me a couple hundred kilos of pure heroin, and I get me a couple of $1 billion, give me a couple hundred keys of cocaine too, just for the heck of it. And I'll take that money and I'll leave y'all alone and I'll go by one of the biggest islands I can find out there and I'll stay away from, as far away from y'all as I can get. That's the only reason. If I were to take a dystopic view that they're gonna mess everything up, right, I would try to get as far away from them as I can. You know, because the trends of history, it's hard to change trends. And then the weight of it, like the big trucks on the highway, when they going down, the police always wait at the bottom of the hill, right? Why? Because the thing's gonna pick, you, anything out there, gonna pick up speed on the way down. It's just automatic, the weight of it, the momentum. So you wanna give a ticket, you wait at the top of the hill, you ain't gonna get nobody up there, but if you're down at the bottom of the long tracks of highway, you're gonna get just about everybody. Unless they're on cruise control, because they're gonna automatically pick up speed. A system in decline, the decline in American life, let's say if it started in 1980, just say, okay, it creeped and creeped, and it's accelerated. Right? And all the stuff we took for granted in 1975 don't exist anymore. It just don't exist. Okay, so we have a choice. Whether we're gonna take a dystopic view or a utopic view. So, that means that puts you in a little bit of dreamland. Now, the ayats that I gave everybody, I'm going to start at number 10. And shown him two highways, but he had not no haste on the path that is steep. And what will explain to thee The Path That Is Steep, The Freeing of the Bondsman, or The Giving of Food, The Day of Privation, to the orphan who claims relationship, to the indigent down in the dust. Then it goes on, it says, then will he be of those who believe and enjoy patience, constancy, self-restraint, and deeds of kindness. This is just like Wallace almost. Thumma kana min alladhina amanu wa tawaso bisabri wa tawaso bil marhama, from Rahman. So this is almost the same as, you know, by the time, you know, joining the right, but this is almost the same. So, what in the world is this thing talking about? Before it got there, though, it says, from 7, thinketh he that none beholdeth him. Have we not for him a pew, made for him a pair of eyes, a tongue, and a pair of lips, and shown him the two highways? Now, we're taking the two highways. Utopia or dystopia? So, at the crossroads, humanity always has some choice. And it's basically the same. Which way are you going to take? The utopian view or the dystopian view? Now, if you take the dystopian view, you can just cruise on along. Just get in the mix, and that the river of dystopia will take you to the ocean of despair and destruction. That is kind of poetic. Yeah, I just thought of that. But it's true. But if we were to just check out a few of his words, you won't see it in that. This is another, you would see it in the Arabic. So Allah gave the human being the ability, gave him two eyes, gave him everything he needs, tongue, speech, and lips, and show him the two broad ways. And then they use the words hadana. Hadana is from hadiya, from guidance, hidayah. We gave him guidance, I mean, we showed him, we guided him, we gave him guidance. Najdayan is two high lines or broad ways. Like they used to have a street always Broadway. That was the main street. It was broad and wide. And it was either Broadway or Main Street. You know the Main Street or the Broadway.
Yeah.
That's what Broadway, everybody think Broadway means the show street for shows. No, Broadway was just the main street. That's why it was Broadway. But Allah showed us two ways, the way of utopia, the way of dystopia, the way of the high road or the low road. Ittaham. He stormed, he rushed, he broke into, he embarked on. Or even he defied. What does that mean? But he has not defied the difficult task. In other words, he have not defied the overwhelming weight of failure on taking the right road. Because the chances of going that way are very slack. So you don't see him storming that road. Let me get, don't hold me back. Let me get over there and take that road, right? No, although you've been shown the two broad roads, but he has not defied the difficult track, the hard road. Of course, track That road is steep and it's difficult, usually a mountain road. So this translation said, the road that is steep, I think. Did he say the road that is steep? Yeah. But he had not made no haste on the path that is steep. Neither has anybody else, have they? Hardly anybody else takes the utopian road. Most everybody else, either through fear or inertia of going along, see, going along with big numbers is the common. I mean, it's very few people that go against the society or your peer group, you know. People just don't do that. It's natural to follow in, and it's unnatural to stand up to the whole group and say, I don't think that's right, I think y'all are wrong. Because you're gonna be by yourself, and the human being is a social animal, therefore he likes being with the people. That's why one of the first things the systems do to you, if you're in prison and you defy them, they isolate you. If you're out here, they isolate you, they cut you off, they cut back your business, right? They go to your friends and wives, children, and they try to cut you out. To be isolated is a terrible thing for a human being. Unless they get isolated so much they actually like it. That can usually happen. Just like some people stay in the war so long, they like the war, right? They don't even want no peace. What do I want peace? There ain't no war. What am I gonna do? They don't say it in words, but they can't function without war. Okay, I'm gonna speed up on this, I take all day. But he had not defied the difficult trials. He had not took the steep highway. What will inform you what the difficult track is? Does it set free the slave or to feed the one indigent or down in the dust? So that means fop, one of the words used to separate, disjoint, tear, bind, but it means to untie, to redeem, to liberate, to emancipate. So the uphill road is first of all move toward liberating the people, emancipating the people from either the system, from the job place, from the military attitude, and liberate their minds and their spirit. That's the uphill road, and that's the steep road. That's the utopian road. So don't nobody want to take that road. That's why we refer, remember we talked about religions first, remember Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, peace be upon all of them. Why we say religion first? We had passed it out. The religion, because they have the idea, love for humanity, love for the poor, right? Well, all religions, blessed are the peacemakers, blessed are the poor, blessed are the, if the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, came back, he would be at the poor. He would be at the poor. He was with the poor. All of our religions basically teach that. Even in Judaism, they have glening. Anybody know what glening is? Glening is that you grow crops. And the Jews in the old days, they could not harvest the corners. You know, if this whole thing is planted. You have to leave the corners for the poor to come out, and they can take that. It was a custom. You could only harvest all the stuff, straight lines up and down here, but you could not, the owner could not harvest the corner. That's why we know what glenning means, it means to glen, to take it. Glenning means that you could go out to the field and you could harvest the corners, the poor, so the poor wouldn't starve to death. Why? Because they're gonna hit each farm and they're gonna wear them corners out. Of course, they're gonna ease up a little bit in there, but they're poor, so they ain't gonna starve to death. That's the law. You couldn't harvest the corners. Okay? So, we got these two worldviews, and what do they mean? Let me see if we got something here that gives us two highways of life. The steep and difficult path of virtue, which is further described in the following verses, the easy path to vice and rejection of Allah referred to in other verses below. Allah has given us not only the faculties implied in the eyes, the tongue, and the lips, but also given us judgment by which we can choose our way. This is where we're coming from. That's in 638, I think. The difficult path, 640, defined as the path of charity and unselfish love. The reason we choose religion, we say the religion. Now think about it. We go on for the whole world, all the people in the world. But just imagine, why would we go toward religion first? Because all we ask the people do is practice your religion. I want you to imagine the churches in America practicing the teachings of Jesus. Like 15, 20% is sufficient. Okay. Did any of y'all see that Chasing Heroin Frontline on TV? Mm-hmm. Okay. Did you see it?
Yeah.
You notice that all them people was up in Washington and the white folks. Do you know? Right. All white folks. They showed one Negro on there. But they showed something, I just watched it the other night. And they had Kent Washington, that's spelled by CL. They had Bremerton. If you know Bremerton, my goodness. Bremerton, I happened to go to Bremerton to raise some funds. I gave a talk there, I had to be 30 years ago. It ain't no middle class, white folkish, more place in the world than Bremerton, Washington, right on Puget Sound. It's a beautiful place, beautiful environment and everything. One of the dope capitals up there. You notice their attitude now was not punishing people. The heroin addicts up there now, they just, oh, you don't have to throw you, they don't even arrest them. They don't arrest them anymore. And they show all the upper middle class white kids that's been affected by heroin and how the mean cartels had watched them and said that everybody, the medical people is passing out all these opiate pills to people, is turning out heroin addicts. For us, they didn't show, it was one Negro, as if Negro addicts have disappeared. And if you watch any TV, you've seen the commercials, they have a lady who's supposed to have cancer. If you wouldn't treat her this way, why would you treat a heroin or opiate? It's a disease. Cancer's a disease. Dope is a disease. Well, it was mostly liquid. And they say most of the new addicts are middle class white people. And they get hooked so bad because the upper middle class, and they say it in words, and they show little blonde-headed girls that were the great baseball team players and great future. How they OD'd, how they, and they show it as this is terrible. So you can get ready. They're going to legalize heroin and cocaine. They're going to have to. They're going to slip up on it. But of course, so late that it's still, but they ought to legalize it right away for them, not for us. But they are. not for Muslims. But we for them legalizing. And give them a couple of good shots every day and they can function normally. Just like Ray Charles, he kept singing. Half our jazz musicians, they function well. Just give them a little bit every day. And if you produce it pharmaceutically, man, you can produce, it won't cost you, a shot of heroin wouldn't cost you no more than $1 a piece.
You know, actually, today on the book TV channel, there's supposed to be a talk where they're going to talk about just what you're saying, where how to re-examine. They're going to go back to the Haight-Ashbury period, and they talked about how it produced these computer geniuses. So now they're going to talk about how to re-examine the whole drug thing.
Don't do that, because it's white folks. It's white folks. It's just
the real issue.
That's at 6:30 today.
That's why message to white folks. This thing, now here we are. We've lived through all the answers. We're the experts on it. We're gonna help them. That's what we're trying to do right now. We're trying to help Americans to jump over a little bit. Here's our situation. Historically, America cannot reach number one the way they're going. Again, we got to sell them on how you can become number one again. Is lead the modern world into a new world dispensation, like you did with democracy. They did. That was the first so-called Thoreau and all of them didn't make it, but this, you know, these white folks, just a lie. I mean, no, we didn't do much, but I mean, they did. Here you are, Mr. White Man. You, with your power and your ability and your vision, can bring the whole world toward a whole new, you gotta sell it. In America, you gotta sell it. I don't care how good your product is, if don't nobody get it, if you can't distribute it to people, you might as well keep it in the house. You can have the best peanut butter in the world. You can make the best pie, blueberry pie, in the world. If don't nobody know it, you just eat your own pies. So we gotta let the world know we got the way out. We do. Not to call it Islam and all that, but the two audiences. The two audiences is the good American people. Remember the theme, America the good, not America the great. You see what I mean? So what does America the good look like? We gotta draw the picture for them. That America, where they was faced with the struggle, let's think about these Americans, of